Today, we are going on a rum tasting tour here at Rome del Barrilito. And this is one of the famous Puerto Rican rums, at least here in Puerto Rico. So, looking forward to it. Should be a little tour, a little history here, and it's hopefully a lot of rum drinking. All right, let's go. And the visitor center. I'll go in, check in for our tour, see what we see in there. All I'm here for is the free rum. Of course, it's not really free, is it? Since it costs us $80 each.
Oh, yeah.
All right, time to go into the visitor center. Luis is gonna get us in here. Hola.
Hola.
Standard here in Puerto Rico. The temperature taken. Hola.
You need to take your temperature.
Si, si.
Hi, can I help you guys?
We have a 3 o'clock tour.
3 o'clock, Nate? You guys going to be looking for you around here at 3 o'clock, okay?
Yep.
Okay. Will I be able to buy more tokens?
Of course.
Oh,
at the bar.
At the bar, okay. That's what I came for. All right, this is what we came for. The tasting, the drinking. I don't know, it's one of those two. Tasting, drinking. But reading from the card here, this is the birthplace of Puerto Rico's oldest rum. The main menu. Cocktail of the month, Santa Ana Sangria. Oh, look at that.
This is my La Hacienda. It seems like it's sort of like a mojito. Coconut cream on top.
Came out here to the little terrace. A few other people out here. And here is mine. I can't wait to take my first sip.
We have been making Ron del Barrilito in this very same place for 141 years already. Hopefully we continue to go for at least another 141, right? But it all began a long, long time ago in 1880 with Pedro Fernandez, that man in the top picture. Pedro's goal was to make a rum that was different to what you will find here in Puerto Rico as rum. You have to keep in mind, rum was still in a relatively early stage of its life, at least in Puerto Rico. Rum was evolving. But before Pedro's time, his grandfather had established all of this already in the late 1700s. His family's business was sugar. Remember that rum, by definition, must be made from sugarcane, so he was in the right place. In order to make a better quality rum, look for inspiration, Pedro decided to look into the world of cognac. While rum, in his day, was still seen as a bit of a drink with very poor quality standards and unrefined, a drink that hadn't taken that background of pirates and criminals. Cognac was the complete opposite. People thought about cognac as a refined, elegant drink, sophisticated. As Pedro learned more about cognac, he began to realize the process for making cognac and the process for making rum is very similar. So the difference has to be in the details. What are they doing that rum is not? And will that even work for rum in the first place? So when he returned to Puerto Rico from France, where he got his engineering degree, he began to apply many of these techniques and methods in the process of making rum. One of the first things he did, he brought the still from France with him. This is a copper pot still, the same type that was used for cognac in his day. While fundamentally the same as any still that you will have found in Puerto Rico, at the time it was more modern and more advanced, thus allowing him to produce a better quality rum in a shorter amount of time. Using that still, he began to make his own rum, which he will often share with friends, family, and neighbors. To do so, he will take some of that rum, and after having aged it for a few years, he will put some of it in a small-sized barrel that he could carry with him. As he visited friends and family, he will share his rum to get their feedback, so that next time that he made more, it could be better. What started as a hobby Gained the family's business. As he noted that he didn't have to walk too far anymore, people would come here, knock on his door. Pedro, how are you doing? By the way, you still have rum in the little barrel? And he will be happy to share it. In 1880, he decides, well, if people like my rum so much, may as well make something out of it. So in 1880, he began to sell the rum, calling it, as many people already had called it unofficially before, Ron del Barrilito, literally, rum from a little barrel.
Was this his house?
Hmm? Not here, but I'll show you. It's still around. So let me show you what exactly is it that we do here, how we make the rum. By the time we're done, you're going to be rum experts.
Like Pedro's grandfather. Around us, you can still see some of the old structures from that day. Like that one just ahead. Back then, that was a windmill, built in 1827 as a sugarcane crusher. In Spanish, we call that atrapiche. Right there where you see the little window, that's where you will have the windmill. So turn it around, you will grind and crush the sugarcane to extract the sugarcane juice, which will later go to that ruin over there. There's not much left of it, mostly overgrown. But that was a boiler room where you will get to the sugar crystals, and also you could use that after refining the sugar for the production of molasses. Molasses is what is most often used for the production of rum, at least in Puerto Rico. By the early 1900s, the production of sugar was already in a steady decline in Puerto Rico. This day and age, Puerto Rico does not produce any significant quantities of sugarcane. The rum industry brings molasses from all over the world, however, mostly locally here in the Caribbean, but in some occasions it can come from places like Fiji or Indonesia. Those molasses are then used for the production of rum. You can see we still have a little bit of sugarcane around here, but just for decoration, mostly to give a connection to our heritage and our past. But it's no longer used for the production directly. Later, when we go to the factory, I'll tell you more about how rum del Barrilito is made. This is our coopery, where we give maintenance to the barrels that we have. When I show you the barrels, we're going to go into one of the barrel aging warehouses. But just like everything, the barrels, with enough time, may begin to deteriorate, and some of them will require maintenance work. This is where we do it. We do not build barrels here, because unlike bourbon, rums do not usually work with new barrels. Many rums, and we're no exception, prefer a cured barrel. Most rums in Puerto Rico use ex-bourbon barrels. That's one of the things that makes this brand different. While our barrels are still made out of American oak, the same wood you will find in a bourbon barrel, the barrels that we use come from Spain after having been used to age Oloroso sherry wine. That will give the rum a very particular flavor. When we step into the barrel aging warehouse and you smell them, you're going to notice it has a sweet aroma that's very usual to find in sherry wine. But don't take my word on it, let me show you.
Welcome to rum heaven, everybody. And I love this place. So this is how you make rum.
Wow.
Every single one of these barrels, you see? Every one of them is full of rum. There's no placeholders here. There's no empty barrels in here. They're all aging and producing rum. And you will see barrels of all kinds. Barrels as young as those all the way up there to the top, which if you look at the bottom left of that piece of paper, you can see when it was filled. That's a barrel from February of 2021, so that's only a few months old. Immediately under, you can see barrels from 2003. And if we keep looking around, you'll see barrels like this from 1985. This is 35-year-old rum. And I have great news. You guys are going to be drinking this today. Because you are all going to try Ron del Barrilito 5 Stars, which is aged up to 35 years. These barrels, like this one, some of them are very neat because they still have this little piece of paper here. And each of these years that you see in there has been a reuse of this barrel in particular. We can reuse these barrels. This one, it's a little blurry, but you can see we have been using this one since 1961. This barrel is 60 years old. The average lifetime of one of our barrels is about 30 years, but some can last much longer than that. One of the things that you may have noticed already or you will notice soon enough, is that if you keep looking around, the years for these barrels, well, they do not seem to be very well organized. It seems kind of random. There's a purpose to doing things like this. It's not that we're disorganized. There's a purpose behind this. Don't put all of your eggs in the same basket. Imagine that we only had barrels here from the 1980s. And these all went up in flames. You will lose all of those barrels that were 30 years and over. So to keep that from happening, all of the six warehouses that we have a little bit of everything. Young barrels, old barrels, medium-aged barrels, they all have a little bit of everything. Remember that the purpose of all of these barrels is to provide the spirit inside with flavors and aromas. And that's part of what you guys will be experiencing today in the rum tasting. Since you're gonna try every one of the rums that we make, you will see, stage by stage, how the rum changes and evolves. The truth is that we only make one rum here. All of the rums that you're gonna try are the same rum. The difference between them is the age of those rums. And as a result, they vary drastically. Think about going through an old album of pictures, looking through your life since you were a kid, all the way until today. In those pictures, well, it's you in all of them, but you certainly look different now than when you were 3 years old. Yeah. Even though some people behave the same, but that's a different story, right? But that's the same thing that's going on here. It's the same product, just different results and different characteristics based on the picture. So this is where the process of making rum that I'm doing truly begins for us. An important topic to cover today is that this is not a rum distillery. This is a rum factory. We do make rum here, but what's the difference between a distillery and a factory? In a distillery, first, you produce the alcohol by fermenting and distilling. And depending on how you produce your product, that earlier stage can be more or less important to what happens later. The way that rum is typically made in Puerto Rico, rum is distilled to a very high proof. So it will have very little flavor initially. Most of the flavor will come from what happens afterwards. After the years of the prohibition in the 1920s, the family was understandably concerned about what will happen should the possibility of a future president reinstated the prohibition happen again. A lot of people do not realize, but remember, Puerto Rico was already a part of the United States when the prohibition happened. The prohibition did have an effect in this place. We had to stop making rum here. What the family did during those years, they started producing rubbing alcohol, medicinal alcohol. If you think about it, not that different with what's been going on with the world today, as many distilleries began to produce hand sanitizer, alcohol for hospitals. It was a similar situation back then, but due to a different reason. So as they began to produce rum again, once the prohibition ended, they said, well, in order to be careful, let's just rent equipment and space with any of our distillery neighbors and produce the alcohol off-site. To this day, that's how we continue to do that. Different distilleries, we do have our own equipment that we rent, we use it, and we bring the alcohol that's produced there over here, made to our specifications. From that point on, we carry on with the process of making that rum into ron de Barrilito. To do this, we begin right here. This tanks, this is a process known as maceration. It's a very simple technique, but a very effective one. And this is another one of the legacies that Pedro adopted from members of the cognac community. Well, this is not a requirement or necessarily practiced by every single cognac. It is a very popular practice. So if you like cognac, there's a good chance that one of your favorites goes through a similar process. In this tanks, the alcohol is added still on a fairly high proof. Then different fruits or spices are added into each one of them so that the alcohol will extract those flavors and aromas. We use natural dehydrated fruits in them. After a period of 6 months absorbing and extracting those aromas and flavors, a little bit of each one of them will be selected, to be combined into the formula into the larger tank here, marriage tank. That combination of flavors in a very precise amount is the formula that makes Ron del Barrilito, the same formula that has been passed down to each generation of master blender, from the days of Pedro all the way until today. That's why if you were to ask me, so Edgar, what are some of the secret flavors that they use here? Well, sadly, they don't tell me that much. That is part of the secret. But it is a formula that has been carefully guarded and passed down through generations. It is out of this tank after that formula has been created that we will be using what's in here to refill the barrels. This is what goes into a barrel. You can see that right now there's not a lot left because last week we were refilling barrels. The barrels that we had drained to make the rum that we're bottling this week. This is not a continuous process when we're doing the same thing over and over. As you've seen, this is a fairly small place. It is a batch process. So in different times of the month, we will be working in different stages of said process. For our heroes who make Ron del Barrilito daily for you, manage to bottle. They just earlier today finished a production run of bottling. Right now they're fixing some of the misplaced labels in some of the bottles and reapplying them. Earlier today, as they bottle, the way this operates is that they bring the empty bottles up here and start placing them in the line. The first station will fill the bottles like this. There's one in the corner, it will tap the bottle, and the third one will label the bottles. The bottles then come out of this other end, and they will begin placing them in this table. Imagine this whole thing full of bottles. The bottles will be packaged for distribution into those kinds of boxes by hand, one bottle at a time. From here, it leads to the rest of Puerto Rico, and since a few years ago, we also sell Ron del Barrilito in some of the states in the United States. Right now, we're available in almost half of the states, close to 25 states, mostly states in the East Coast, but there are some states in the West Coast that also have it, like California, for example. Good rule of thumb, if your state is known to have a lot of Puerto Ricans, you will likely find Ron del Barrilito. Oh yes, you'll find it there. You'll find it. Right. Puerto Ricans know the good stuff when they see it, so. But, after having had and seen all of this, the big question is, are you ready to try it?
Yes.
Right this way.
So thanks for joining us on a tour of Hacienda Santa Ana, where they make Ron del Barrilito. Barrilito rum, which is the oldest rum in Puerto Rico. We paid $80 for this tour, and it was great learning how they make the rum. Next time, we're going to learn how it tastes. So until then, may your suitcase always be messy. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel and ring the bell to be notified of our next videos. Hasta luego!